A warm welcome to this workshop. My name is Linda Marie Rustad. I'm director at Kilden genderresearch.no in Norway. And Kilden is a partner in this project I'm going to introduce you to. So welcome to this workshop on gender sensitive leadership. What does it take? This is part of an EU-funded project. It's funded under the Science Sweden for Society and the EU Commission under Horizon 2020. And the name of the project is GE Academy. It is Gender Equality Academy, Dissemination of Gender Knowledge. So this project develops and also have initiatives like this of high quality capacity building training programs. So we are offering different kinds of trainings, such as in-person trainings. We have had several webinars and also this interactive participatory workshop, which you are joining today. Unfortunately, and due to the pandemic, we can't do it in person. We had to switch to do this in digital. But the thought was that we were going to have meeting in person, but as you know, that's difficult these days. So there are several partners included. This picture is from where we still could meet. That was December last year. So it's a lot of actors and stakeholders in Europe behind this project. And you can also look to the website and you will see different courses, training programs that we are offering also next year. As you can see, this is a workshop. It's not an ordinary seminar. So we are looking forward to discussing with you. We are going to follow a process. You will be introduced for a specific methodology developed by the two professors that are joining us today. So you can see here we have four group works, and each and one of you will be in the same group through this workshop. And these you see labeled as 1, 2, 3, and 4 should be considered as steps, different steps in a methodology, how to end up with a very, anchored and action plan for your institution. Okay, so today's trainers, Siri Øyslebø-Sørensen and Vivian Lagesen are both professors at the Norwegian University for Technology and Science. And they have been part of a project financed by the Research Council of Norway called Balance. And it's about gender balance in academia. And the toolbox they will introduce us to is one of the results, the output from this project. And then it is Trine Rogg-Korsvik and me, both work at Kilden Gender Research NO, and we are also partner in this GE Academy project. So I would also say why this now? Why talk about gender-sensitive leadership and gender balance these days? And I think many of you know that the EU, the European Commission has this fall announced that from 2021, and it will be mandatory from 2022, in order to have research funding from Horizon Europe, the next framework program, to have a gender equality plan will be mandatory. And to have a gender equality plan and to be successful in implementing such a plan, you need leadership commitment. And of course, to have a gender equality plan can look very differently. And I think this methodology we are going through today will say something and hopefully have some reflections on how to make this plan fit for your organization and the problems and or challenges you might have. So I think the commission, they just, I think it was some weeks ago, they announced that they will step up the work on gender equality for Horizon Europe. And I think a lot of both research performing organizations and research funding organizations are now thinking, how are we going to meet this challenge? So hopefully today you have some more instruments or methods to think through this. So before we say hello to our trainers, I'm going to share with you a short video they have developed as part of their projects.
Gender balance benefits everyone and is about more than fairness and equality. As well as improving and making working environments more attractive, it can lead to greater cooperation, stimulate creativity, and enhance reputation. Gender balance problems aren't the same everywhere, and there isn't a one-size-fits-all approach to tackling them. Researchers at the Norwegian University of Science and Technology have developed a toolbox to help departments make gender balance part of their daily operation. The toolbox starts with practical steps to help departments analyze and understand their current situation. It then offers pragmatic advice on the development and implementation of a feasible gender balance strategy. The toolbox provides examples to help departments set clear, realistic, and measurable goals. It also suggests different measures for the different problems departments may have. Concise and easy to use, the toolbox can help change gender balance from an issue into a resource.
Okay, that was the short introduction. I will now give the screen to Vivian and Siri, who will make a short introduction to the toolbox. And they will also guide us through the day and for the different group sessions we are going to have. And the four trainers of us will also be part of the steps and the breakout sessions. So, welcome, Siri and Vivian.
My name is Vivian Nøtte-Lagesen, and together with Siri, Øystebø Sørensen, and Linda and Trine, we will lead you through this workshop on how to use the toolbox for gender-sensitive leadership. Now, Siri and I have worked for many years, done research on gender leadership and inclusion strategies from several projects in higher education, in business organizations, and in industry. And our latest project that we will build on here is on local gender balance in academia. So, but even if our examples are mainly taken from an academic context, we believe that this is transferable to most other organizations and institutions in science. You have already received the toolbox, and in the following few hours, we will guide you through a group work to give you a taste of how the toolbox is meant to be used. And the purpose is to give you an idea of a sense of what we mean by this toolbox, and also to encourage a process or encourage to initiate a process that is based on the toolbox when you get back to your respective units. Now, what is gender sensitive leadership? In our view, it needs to be based on research and what we have called local knowledge making. And the reason for that is that gender balance is very significantly on a local level. And in academia, it has been quite common to assume that the problem of gender balance is the same everywhere. However, there are huge differences between academic departments, between small units, like for example, research groups. So this suggests that local cultural organizations are important factors. And local variations in gender balance indicate that there are no one-size-fits-all with regard to measures. And that is why there is a need to investigate what the problem with gender balance is to before deciding on measures and initiatives. So to do such an analysis is an important part of doing gender-sensitive leadership. In other words, performing gender-sensitive leadership begins with undertaking local investigations to better grasp the features of the local situation with regard to gender balance. And there's no doubt that top leadership is very important too, but top leaders are often not well positioned to know about the specificities of the local situations. So local leaders are in a better position to analyze gender balance problems at hand, which is essential to be able to make targeted and more efficient strategies to improve gender balance. So top-down leaderships need to be combined with gender-sensitive bottom-up leadership. Now, the toolbox for gender-sensitive leadership is meant to help with exactly that, how to investigate and analyze the local situation and make them make strategies that are better targeted and more efficient. And moreover, in order to achieve organizational change, measures need to be followed up, it needs to be evaluated, and it needs to be done so on a regular level, and to make necessary corrections and amendments. And for many of you, those that sounds like a very taken for granted or obvious thing that, you know, organizational change requires evaluations, but it's actually, we have found that gender balance measures are often based on either assumptions or often also just more general advices or what other people tell them. So how to use the toolbox? In the following, we will give you a brief overview, or I will give you a brief overview of how, some aspects of the toolbox that will help you perform gender-sensitive leadership. And after that, we will try it out in practice through doing group work in 4 steps. And given the time limit, this will be a very intensive process, but we will do our best to guide you through it. Now, the purpose of doing this as a group work is for you to reflect and become aware of how situations and problems with regard to gender balance may be very different, and to have the opportunity to share experiences and discuss the situation in your unit with others, and to reflect upon those differences. So the first step is to map the situation with regard to gender balance. How is the gender balance in the different job categories? How is it among students? How is the situation in different research groups? Also, has the imbalance changed during the last 5 or 10 years? And if so, how has it changed? Also, are there particular patterns like leaking pipelines, for instance? Where does it leak? Or is the problem that there is a general lack of women to recruit all the way from the student level, for instance? So these patterns vary quite a lot between departments and units. It could also be helpful to look into the last 5 hiring processes and to investigate how was the proportion of men and women applicants compared to gender those who were appointed and eventually employed. And the tools for doing such mapping can be quite simple. It can be counting, looking at websites, using available statistics, etc. Now, the next step is to assess the situation in more in-depth. How does your employees or colleagues experience the gender balance and the situation in their units? Is it considered to be a problem? Is gender balance considered to be a problem? And if so, by who and why? Do they, for instance, consider gender to be relevant in relation to career development, division of labor, or work environment? And how about the PhD students? Do they consider academia as an attractive workplace for the future? And knowledge on such things can be used to encourage and support career planning from quite early on in order to build a recruitment base. So it's nothing wrong about doing a little bit of long-term thinking, which I'm sure you do already, but nevertheless. And which tools can be used for this? Department seminar is a good place to start. Sometimes problems or issues can be difficult to talk about. It can be a matter of particularly forms of humor, inappropriate jokes, or practices that exist that make some people uncomfortable, etc. And these things may be easier to address in more smaller groups, like the focus groups, interviews, etc. Appraisals are also a very important instrument for local leaders. You might also think about doing simple surveys It can be useful to explore more sensitive topics, etc. So there are, you can find more suggestions in the toolbox for how to do this. And you can seek expertise from the outside also. And all in all, this investigation or this and this mapping should lead to some kind of understanding of what the gender balance problem is, which could be things like, for example, is there anywhere gender balance problems are particularly striking on a particular level? Is it the master degree program? Is it the transition between associate professor and professorship, etc.? Or are there any sections or research group that stand out as particularly positive or negative? And what kinds of improvements are wished for from the academic or the social environment or the employees? So this understanding may of course be amended. So it's important to emphasize that this attempt to understand the problem never ceases. It's an ongoing project, and also because it in many cases are moving targets. But however, this problem definition should provide some basis for making a plan. The toolbox provide input into how to make such a mapping and assessment, and how to go forward to make such a plan. And there could be many common problems, areas, or goals with regard to improving gender balance. I will just give you two examples here to make sort of a illustration of what it could be. One common problem is that it's difficult to hire women. So the toolbox offers suggestions for things to consider based on research on what has proved to be helpful measures with regard to hiring processes. And this could, for example, be to appoint associate professor rather than full professors, or to map potential applicants on beforehand and shape the announcements or calls so that one makes sure that these are included and encouraged also to apply. And not just by saying that women are encouraged to apply in the call, but to make the announcement or shape the announcement so that you know that potential women applicants will be attracted to the position to apply. Also, personal encouragement for women to apply to make them feel welcome has been found to be important measures. We know, for example, that a long deadline increases the probability that more women apply. And also instructing committees to make categories rather than individual rankings. And also remind about the risk for unconscious bias, because research has shown that if people are aware or become aware or are made aware of the risk of being gender biased, that actually helps to reduce gender bias in such processes. So to provide for better gender balance in top academics position, it's important that women and other minorities who are to be recruited or already employed by the department are encouraged and supported to qualify themselves. And this can be done in a number of ways, individual follow-up, network sharing, advice and mentoring, support network. So I think a key point here is to emphasize that it is particularly important to design for inclusion, and the need to be included is greater for people who belong to minority groups. And it's particularly important to make sure that they feel welcome and that they feel valuable to the department and to the environment. And it's, of course, important that all employees do that. But we know that minorities are particularly vulnerable to bad environments, bad working environments, bad practices, etc. So improving that helps everyone, but it helps particularly those in a minority position. So comments with regard to making an action plan or to planning for change. A few more overall points. Change doesn't happen automatically. It has been commonly believed that changes instituted from below by, for example, evening out the student population will propagate upwards through the system. It's just a time lag. this idea of that there is sort of a lag or an inertia that sort of lead to that will sort of sort it out itself. That is not entirely wrong, but one should not assume that changes happen automatically. It may actually go in the wrong direction. And our study of gender balances has shown that while there is overall looking quite good in the sense that the gender balance are improving with 1% a year, at least with our institutions, we also found that the variation between the development in gender balance were very different from department to department, so that some departments had no improvements. And that was typically the most male-dominated departments, while there were actually fields and departments that are becoming dominated by women. So that what we may see is also a sort of gender segregation that sort of are masked in, because we always use these aggregated numbers that just show the mean of the development. So don't take it for granted that things are going in the right direction or that it goes automatically in that direction. Clearly, someone needs to be responsible. The department heads in the academic context is by default responsible, but the task can also be delegated to others. So, but regardless of that, it's important that the department head demonstrates that he or she supports the work symbolically and practically in order to give such work legitimacy. Measures need to be sorted by also top leadership. We know that, but it also needs to be quite well anchored among all the employees. So don't just think enrolling top leadership, also think about enrolling everyone, also at the lower level on the organization. You need both. Also, initiating several measures at the same time, we know, gives a stronger effect that might lead to what we have called a positive circle of inclusion. It's more about that in the toolbox. And also plan for regularly evaluations and also how to evaluate. And it's important to make amendments and adaptations to the measures or in the plan as we go along. So these are some of the other resources that you may turn to, and there are also, I think, even more in the toolbox.
Yeah, but these problems that you have in mind, they probably require different tools or different strategies. So Vivian, can you please just give us this short introduction of possible tools?
Clearly, gender imbalances is a very complex problem. And there are not one thing or one problem, but there are many problems, and they are often building upon each other, and they are part of a larger structure with different elements that goes in that sort of reinforces patterns and also reinforces how gender imbalances are produced and reproduced. So it's difficult to pinpoint or to choose one particular problem or problem definition clearly. So the thing is that you need to do something in order to make things happen, in order to improve matters and improve gender balances. So the question is sort of, where do you start? Where do you begin? And that may be something you need to think about and to figure out. And sometimes you, for an action plan, in a full-blown action plan, you will need probably to start on many different issues at the same time. For the sake of this workshop and for this training, just to get you or give you the idea about the process and what we emphasize as very important things to keep in mind, is that you need to investigate and gain some knowledge and gain some overview over what you think you know and that you might be right about, but that you also need to sort of look into. And also just doing that can in itself be a measure, an important instrument for also raising the awareness among the people that you are asking or discussing things with, etc. So just putting on it on the agenda is in itself an important measure. So that was just. So the toolbox do offer some measures, some instruments that you may use for different purposes, depending on what your problem you think are the most important that you would do something about. And this is, of course, not I just remembered the Norwegian word for it. This is not a complete list, of course. And we also encourage you to think for yourself, because sometimes there aren't any particular measures that already exist for what might be your problem, or what you can think of your own solutions. And that was also what we encouraged to do in our project with these 12 departments in our university, to also try to find or work with innovative initiatives. You know, perhaps aren't the initiatives that others have used the best initiatives, etc. So that we also encourage you to think about new ways of addressing the issue or working with gender imbalance. So these that are mentioned here are just some examples that you can find in the toolbox. I don't think I will use a lot of time to go into them because they are described in the toolbox. So the point is that you need to be concrete. You need to think about, for the sake of this process at least, choose one that you would need to work further on in order to make a plan for how you can proceed to do that.